गुड आफ्टरनून स्टूडेंट, वी आर लर्निंग इंडियन इकोनॉमी द सब्जेक्ट ऑफ टीवाई बीकॉम इन विच वी आर लर्निंग द ऑब्जेक्टिव एंड स्ट्रेटजी ऑफ इकोनॉमिक प्लानिंग इन इंडिया. सो वील टेक अ वेरी क्विक रिविजन द टॉपिक विच अप टू नाउ हैज हैव बीन कवर्ड इन दिस. सो First, we have learned the objective of economic planning in India, the long-term objective. Then we have discussed that the socio-economic objective, how classified into two, economic planning and removal of poverty, in which is classified in two section, and economic planning and social justice, which also classified in a two section. Then evolution of the long-term objective of planning. What is democratical socialism in India was covered. We have learned this with the help of features of democratical socialism in India. Now we are going to learn, India is a mixed economy. So, India is regarded as a good example of mixed economy. Under the directive principle of the Indian Constitution, it has been laid down that the state should strive to promote the welfare of the people by securing and protecting as effectively as it may a social order in which justice, social, economic, and political shall inform all the institutions of national life. So we will learn this under three hats. First, the positive economic role of state. In the economic sphere, the state is to direct its policy to secure a better distribution of ownership and control of the material resources of the community and to prevent concentration of wealth in the hands of a few and the exploitation of labor. It would be impossible for the state to attain these ends implied in the directive principle unless the state itself enters the field of production and distribution. This explains the rationale behind the deliberate policy of expansion of the public sector to promote rapid industrialization and self-reliance. To protect the weaker section, the state is also expected to control the distribution of essential commodities. Similarly, by controlling the financial system, that is insurance and banking, the state can endeavor to direct investment in socially desirable channels. Besides, in a poor and underdeveloped country like India, nowadays we call it developing India, market forces based on profit motive cannot by themselves induce the private sector to move into infrastructural development, which involve heavy capital investment, a long gestation period, low rate of interest, etc. Okay, so the private sector to move in the infrastructure development, which involve heavy capital investment, long gestation period, low rate of interest, etc. Accordingly, the state has to promote infrastructural facilities like hydroelectric project, irrigation, road and railways, transportation, and has to create conditions conducive to a higher level of investment so that national and per capita income of the people can be improved. and this can be improved continuously. This was an important reason for the creation of dominance of the public sector in India during the first three decades of planning. The second is coexistence of public and private sector. India, the state democratic, the area for the promotions of industries in the public and the private sectors. This division was specified in the Industrial Policy Resolution 1956. In the first category, were include such industries whose development would be the exclusive responsibility of the state. In the second category, were included such industries which would be progressively state-owned. But the private sector may be permitted to supplement the efforts of the state. In both these categories, the state wanted to deliberately push the expansion of the public sector with a view to develop industry of basic importance to the economy. Defense and heavy industries to rid of the country from foreign dependence, and infrastructural industries to provide water, energy, and transportation to create conditions favorable for investment in agriculture and industry. The nationalization of major commercial banks in 1969 was another big step to channelize investment in social desirable lines of production. Although the public sector was conceived as a senior partner, the public sector was conceived of as a senior partner in the process of economic development in India. The private sector was to be permitted to exist and supplement the efforts of the public sector within the overall framework laid down for the economy. The Planning Commission stated this objective clearly, that in a planned economy, the distinction between the public and the private sector is one of the relative emphasis. The two sectors are and must function as parts of single organism. So actually the organism is a single, but which is divided into two sectors, and they both the sector must have to operate or functions as a part of single organism. Okay. So in the mixed economy, private as well as state both work together. So combined features of capitalism and socialism. The mixed economy has a salient feature of capitalism and of socialism. Very clearly and cleverly incorporated. For instance, the private sector industries are based on self-interest and profit motive. Individual initiative is given full scope, and the system of private property is respected. individual freedom and competition. Individual freedom and competition are allowed to exist. At the same time, it is not free or laissez-faire capitalism, but is controlled capitalism, since free enterprise and initiative, the driving force of self-interest and profit motive, and the system of private property are all limited in the interest of society. On the other hand, the public sector industries are merged and operated on the basis of welfare of the community. The advantages of planning and relatively equality of income are thus sought to be harmonized with the advantage of private initiative and profit motive. In India, therefore, the state is pledged to the establishment of a socialist order of society in which the present glaring inequalities of wealth are sought to be reduced to the minimum. At the same time, the state would not eliminate the system of private enterprise, which, in spite of many shortcomings and obvious handicaps, has been doing a good job in the field of production and growth. So the mixed economy, therefore, is the result of India's commitment to democracy, also to socialism. Okay. Why we call India the mixed economy India? Why? Because it is the we say that it's the result of India's commitment to democracy and also to the socialism. So how we can say India is a mixed economy? Because in India, we can see the positive economic role of the state. There is a coexistence of public and private sector, and combined, we can see the combined feature of capitalism and as well as socialism. So how this is the India is a mixed economy? So introduction of the mixed economy. But if we talk about that, how planning process in a mixed economy, what is the planning process in a mixed economy? Okay, so we say that a mixed economy is necessarily a planned economy. The public sector will have to be operated according to the certain priorities and to achieve certain specified social and economic goals. Accordingly, the public sector has to have an economic plan to guide it. At the same time, the government cannot leave the private sector to develop in its own unorganized manner. Naturally, the government will have to prepare an integrated economic plan in which the private sector will also have a well-defined role. The state will guide, direct, and control the private sector through various incentives. Since a mixed economy operates under the divergent. So since India as a mixed economy operates under the divergent and often conflicting set of motivations, the planning process in a mixed economy is much more complex. am repeating my word. Since mixed economy operates under the divergent and often conflicting set of motivations, the planning process in a mixed economy is much more complex. Obviously, if there is a we can see the role of public as well as private, we can see the combination of capitalism and socialism. So we understand how it is complex as well as difficult to plan. So the conflicting motivations are those of self-interest on the one hand and social gain on the other. The purpose of economic planning in a mixed economy is to reconcile the conflicts interest so that they subserve the national interest. Accordingly, the success of planning in a mixed economy depends upon lot of factors. Okay, the success of planning in a mixed economy depends on lot of factors. So what are these factors? So these factors, first we can say that to what extent is the public sector able to pursue the socially determined goals? Okay, to what extent is the public sector able to pursue the socially determined goal? The second factor, to what extent is the state able to guide the private sector to follow the socially determined goals? And the third factor, to what extent is the state able to check the distortions in investment decisions arising out of private sector interest going against overall objective of the economy? So these are the major three factors, that to what extent is the public sector able to pursue the socially determined goal, to what extent is the state able to guide the private sector to follow the socially determined goals, and to what extent is the state able to check the distortion in investment decision arising out of a private sector interest going against overall objective of the economy. So the government has been making efforts through a very variety of social instruments and measures so that economic activity in India is directed towards the attainment of the long-term socio-economic objectives of planning. So in this regards, or in this the major steps taken in this regards. Now, what are these major steps which were taken? First, the state allocated a very significant proportion of the plan outlays to promote defense, heavy and basic industries. Most of these industries were not developed during the British period. The deliberate promotion of these industries resulted in the creation of an industrial base in the Indian economy. Second, if we say that the second step regarding this is the state has also been allocating a substantial proportion of investment for the creation of economic infrastructure in the form of irrigation works, hydroelectronic projects, roads, railways, post and telegraph, and also shipping and air transport. So substantial expansion of the economic infrastructure has been made, and this has helped in enlarging the size of the market. As well as it help in enlarging the size of the market and has raised the possibility of attaining higher productivity in agriculture and industry, and has enlarged the scope of further productive investment. So the third step, we say the state has been undertaking investment in social infrastructure in the form of educational institution, dispensaries and hospitals, and other institution of social welfare for the disabled. So what was the step? The step says that undertaking investment, the state has been undertaking investment in dispensaries and hospitals, education institution, orphans and other deprived section with a view to create better human capital necessities, which leads to development. The state acquired a dominant control over financial institution. Life insurance was nationalized. The banking system was progressively brought under state ownership and control. The principal purpose of controlling the financial institution was to direct investment in priority areas, mainly to help rural and backward areas and the weaker section of the society. The next step, we say that the state has been using rationing and controls the check the price of articles of essential consumptions so that their availability to the weaker section is ensured at reasonable price. The main purpose of these instruments is to protect the weaker section from the exploitation of the businessmen. The state has been undertaking special programs to help the education and training of the socially backward scheduled caste and tribes and other backward classes and economically weaker section. To that, so we can say that so they can secure better employment in the life. They can be provide equal opportunities for development. These measures, it must be admitted, have helped a large number of children born in the poor families to acquire vertically mobility. So the state has been using the instrument of taxation and public expenditure. State has been using the instruments of taxation and public expenditure, use of fiscal policy so that resources are transferred from the richer section to be used for the welfare of the people. So in this way, we can say that planning process in a mixed economy can be discussed. Now, how planning process destroyed, or we can say that distortion in the planning process. Okay, how the talk about the distortion in the planning process. So I explain it in an easy manner, in a very shortly, I have to explain that the experiment of mixed economy in India has been carried on for over six decades, or more than six decades. Both central and the state government in India set up a several public sector enterprises in many lines of production, trade and finance. In some cases, successful private sector units were nationalized. Insurance company and banks and the central government and road transport system by the state government. Often sick private units were taken over the government or by the government. That is, textile mills and engineering units. Many states set up public sector enterprises just to accommodate party legislators as chairman, to provide them with ministerial status of a prerequisite. Okay. In general, a good number of public sector enterprises in the India have been running inefficiently and involving huge losses of the government and ultimately to the taxpayers. As in the case of Soviet Russia and East European communist countries, the public sector enterprises wasted precious resources and therefore came in for sharp criticism for the general public. Further, the private sector has been constantly and incessantly trying to evade and in many ways distort the planning process. The private sector has corrupted the bureaucracy and the politicians in power. Consequently, relaxation in plan periods were permitted. If we say that the Sabimal Dutt Committee revealed that the government has permitted the private sector to set up the industrial units in area reserved for the public sectors. Similarly, while imports were to be permitted in areas of sophisticated technology, they were permitted in areas of low priority under one pretext or the other. The profit motive and the acquisitive spirit of the private sector on the one side and the inefficiency of the public sector on the other have resulted in serious distortion in the planning period. So the upshot of the analysis which we have done up to now, whether investment is made in the public sector or the private sector, the major beneficiaries of growth have been the big business houses, the big traders, and the landlords, and the relatively better off section of the society. They are the inherent contradiction of the mixed economy. After the reduction of, adoption of liberalization, privatization and globalization, that is LPG model. So the question may be asked to you for macroeconomics, what is LPG? So you have to clear it. Liberalization, privatization and globalization. several decisions were taken which revered the earlier process or the earlier policies. So what will be the decisions taken after LPG, that we will discuss in the next lecture. So in the next lecture we will discuss that how the LPG model has how the LPG model is responsible for the distortion in the planning process. Okay, and we learn the development strategy in India. Okay, with the different heads we will learn, as well as we learn the strategies and different models which were accepted during the plan period. So before I teach you Niti Aayog, Niti Aayog is a new form of planning. So first we have to understand planning, then we will go on the Niti Aayog. Okay, so here I'm stopping the lecture. In the next lecture we will learn the topic which I have just told you. Okay, have a good day.